In everything, give thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Quench not the spirit, despise not prophesying. Prove all things, hold fast that which is good. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman who needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Welcome to the Three Angels Herald Prophecy Seminar. We invite you to take your Bible, pen, and paper as we study the Word of God. Our speaker for today is Jimmy Kakuri.
Welcome once again, my beloved brothers and sisters, in the precious and matchless name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's such a wonderful privilege once again to come into your homes, your churches, or wherever you may be to share God's precious word with you at this time. As usual, God has a precious message in store for us. The study that we'll be endeavoring to go into today is taken from the book of Ezekiel, chapter 47, and really has to do with the mighty river of healing. The mighty river of healing of Ezekiel, chapter 47. However, before we go into our study for the hour, I just want to take this brief moment to go into a prayer thought taken from the book Acts of the Apostles, page 13. And the pen of inspiration says, in Acts of the Apostles, page 13, "Wonderful is the work which the Lord designs to accomplish through his church, that his name may be glorified. A picture of this work is given in Ezekiel's vision of the mighty river of healing." Isn't that beautiful, brethren? "Wonderful is the work," inspiration says, "which the Lord designs to accomplish through his church, that his name may be glorified. And a picture of this work is given to Ezekiel in relation to the mighty river of healing." Now, then inspiration goes on to refer to certain verses in Ezekiel 47. In fact, she quotes Ezekiel 47, verses 8 through to 12. And we're going to be going through these verses. And then she comments, take notice of what she says here in the second paragraph. She says, "From the beginning, God has wrought through his people to bring blessing to the world. To the ancient Egyptian nation, God made Joseph a fountain of life. Through the integrity of Joseph, the life of that whole people was preserved. Through Daniel, God saved the life of all the wise men of Babylon. And these deliverances are as object lessons. They illustrate the spiritual blessings offered to the world through connection with the God whom Joseph and Daniel worshipped." That's very beautiful, brethren. So God has used great men in the past to offer spiritual blessing to the world. And the world received these blessings as they connected themselves with these great men of old. And these were just as object lessons. They illustrate the blessings that the world will receive in connection with the great men of God. So brethren, as we're going through this presentation for today, keep in mind that inspiration says, "Wonderful is the work which the Lord designs to accomplish through his church, that his name may be glorified. And a picture of this work was given to Ezekiel in relation to the mighty river of healing." So with these words in mind, I will now invite you to kneel with me as we petition the throne of grace. Father in heaven, Lord, we want to thank you so much for life and for strength. We thank you so much for your love and your kindness, the multitude of your tender mercies. As we're going through your precious words once again, I pray that you may speak to your people. Anoint me with your Holy Spirit, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. I'll invite you, my beloved brothers and sisters, to take your Bibles and turn to the book of Ezekiel, chapter 47. And we're going to be reading primarily, to begin with, the first five verses. Ezekiel 47, reading through verses 1 through to 5. And the Bible says, "Afterward," Ezekiel says, "he brought me again unto the door of the house, and behold, waters issued out from under the threshold of the house eastward. For the forefront of the house stood towards the east, and the waters came down from under, from the right side of the house, at the south side of the altar. Then brought he me out of the way of the gate northward, and led me about the way without unto the utter gate, by the way that looketh eastward. And behold, there ran out waters on the right side. And when the man that had the line in his hand went forth eastward, he measured 1,000 cubits, and brought me through the waters. The waters were to the ankles. Again he measured 1,000, and brought me through the waters. The waters were to the knees. Again he measured 1,000, and brought me through the waters. The waters were to the loins. Verse 5. Afterward he measured 1,000, and it was a river that I could not pass over. For the waters were risen, waters to swim in, a river that could not be passed over. And may God give us full understanding, my beloved brethren, as we go through this marvelous presentation today. Now, if we go back to verse 1, Ezekiel begins by saying, afterward he, which was the angel, if you look at your pictorial presentation, the angel brought Ezekiel to the door of the house. Now, in verse 1, it says, afterward he brought me again unto the door of the house, and behold, waters issued out from under the threshold of the house eastward, for the forefront of the house stood towards the east. And the waters came down from under, from the right side of the house, at the south side of the altar. So as Ezekiel was led, Ezekiel begins by saying that the angel led him to the door of the house, and he saw waters issuing towards the east. Now these waters, primarily as Ezekiel saw them, he saw them at the right side of the altar, the south side of the altar, the right side of the house, and the south side of the altar. And then the waters begin to take an eastward direction. Now again, we will find out what these waters really symbolize, but the significance is that the waters began, as Ezekiel saw these waters, they were seen at the right side of the house, the south side of the altar. Now remember, there are 4 points to the compass, and here we see that the north is right here, the east, the south, and the west. So as Ezekiel saw these waters at the right side of the house, south side of the altar, and then they take an eastward direction, the waters coming from the south side of the altar shows us that initially they proceeded from the north. They came from the north, and then he saw them at the south side of the altar, and then they take an eastward direction. Now furthermore, Ezekiel saw that this house, the forefront of the house, Ezekiel says, was facing towards the east. Now what is the significance? This house, which we're going to see, really symbolizes true worship, the house of the Lord. But primarily Ezekiel saw this house facing the east, which really again shows us that this house is a symbol of true worship. Because anciently, brethren, if you recall, the sanctuaries or the temples anciently were built or erected facing the east, which was a symbol of true worship. And the reason for that being is this, that when the worshippers went in to the house of the Lord, their backs were then facing the east, showing that this house is indeed a symbol of true worship. Remember that the purpose of our study today is to primarily see the wonderful work which the Lord designs to accomplish through his church, that his name may be glorified. So these waters initially, they proceed from the north. So whatever the waters symbolize, we're going to see they proceeded from the throne of God. We're going to see that the north actually is where God's throne is located. If we go to the book of Psalms, 75, and we're going to be looking at verse 6. In Psalm 75 and verse 6, the Bible says in verse 6, "For promotion cometh neither from the east, nor from the west, nor from the south." Verse 7, "For God is the judge, he putteth down one and setteth up another." Now verse 5 says, "Promotion comes neither from the east, nor from the south, nor from the west." Well, if promotion comes neither from the south, the east, nor the west, then naturally it comes from the north, where God's throne is located. Let's go to another text. In the book of Isaiah chapter 14 and verse 13, the Bible says, referring to Lucifer, "For thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north." Now, why did Lucifer want to ascend into the sides of the north here? Because that's where God's throne is located, brethren, according to the scriptures, showing that these waters initially proceeded from the north, but then Ezekiel saw them at the right side of the house, south side of the altar, and then they take an eastward direction. Now, having understood that these waters primarily issued from the north, we need to further on go on to see now, brothers and sisters, what do the waters really symbolize? What do waters symbolize? Let's go to the book of Revelation. Because remember, in the book Acts of the Apostles, in the spirit of prophecy, inspiration says all the books of the Bible meet and end in Revelation. So let's go to Revelation chapter 17, and we're going to be looking at verse 15. The Bible says, "And he saith unto me, The waters which thou sawest, where the horse sitteth, are peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues." So very clearly we see that waters, in the context, especially of Ezekiel 47, symbolize people. People. So we're going to see the significance right now. Because remember, as we read from Ezekiel chapter 47, verses 2, right through to verse 5, if you noticed, the waters began to swell. In verse 2, in Ezekiel 47, if you go right back there, "Then brought he me out the way of the gate northward, and led me about the way without unto the utter gate that lies eastward. And behold, there ran out waters on the right side." So, the waters began to run out. You will notice that the waters, as they began to run out, again symbolizing people, they were of little significance as they began to run out in comparison to the waters which were just outside the gate. Because if you go into verse 3 to 5, "As the angel began to measure 1,000 cubits, and by the way, you will notice that the angel measures four times. He measures four times. "But as the angel began to measure 1,000 cubits, in verse 3, the waters, Ezekiel says, were to the ankles. In other words, when the angel measured the first time 1,000 cubits, the waters were to the ankles. Then when the angel measured the second time 1,000 cubits, the waters were to the knees." Notice that the waters are growing. "As the angel measured the third time 1,000 cubits, the waters were to the loins. But as he measured the fourth time, as the angel measures the fourth time 1,000 cubits, verse 5 says, Ezekiel says in verse 5, "Afterward he measured 1,000, and it was a river that I could not pass over. For the waters were risen, waters to swim in, a river that could not be passed over." Now what is the Bible really trying to tell us, brethren? Because when the angel measured the fourth time 1,000 cubits, Ezekiel says, it was a river to swim in, a river that could not be passed over. And brethren, we need to dig deep into the mind of God's truth today, remembering that the main focus of this study is to see the reason, the wonderful work which the Lord designs to accomplish through His church, that His name and His name alone may be glorified. Now again, having established that the water symbolized people, and again, the waters in verse 2, Ezekiel 47 verse 2, they began to run out. They didn't flood out or gush out. They begin very small. So the significance is that the waters really are small to begin with, and then as the angel begins to measure 1,000, the first time, the second time, the third time, and the fourth time, the waters began to grow. So in other words, this tiny rivulet swells into a mighty river. And that's the point, brethren. It shows something of rapid growth. The fact that the waters ran out primarily very small, and then as the angel begins to measure 1,000 cubits, the first, the second, the third, and the fourth, it eventually became a river that could not be passed over. Again, showing that this river, although it begins very small, a tiny rivulet, it swells into a mighty river that eventually could not be passed over. So who are these waters, brethren? Who are these waters to begin with? Let's go to the book of Isaiah chapter 2. In Isaiah chapter 2 and verse 2, Isaiah chapter 2 and verse 2, the Bible says, "And it shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established in the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills, and all nations will flow into it." Now verse 2, Isaiah says, "And it shall come to pass in the last days." So Isaiah chapter 2 is talking about a work in the last days. And he says, "It shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Lord's house," his church, "shall be established in the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills." And then Isaiah says, "All nations will flow into it." So many more will be invited to come into God's house in the last days. And then in verse 3, Isaiah says, "And many people shall go and say, Come ye, and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, and he will teach us of his ways," showing that probation is still open, "and we will walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem." The Bible says, brethren, out of Zion in the last days shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. Now, who is Zion? Because the Bible says, out of Zion shall go forth the law in the last days, showing that the law of God is still a binding principle in these last days, brethren. But the point is, the law shall go forth out of Zion. Now, who is Zion? Let's go to Isaiah 51 and verse 16. In the book Isaiah 51 and verse 16, the Bible says, in verse 16, God's word says, "And I have put my words in thy mouth, and I have covered thee in the shadow of my hand, that I may plant the heavens and lay the foundations of the earth, and say unto Zion, Thou art my people." So very clearly we see from the Bible that Zion symbolizes God's people. So going back to Isaiah chapter 2 and verse 3, when the Bible says, "Out of Zion shall go forth the law," that is, out of Zion, the church, God's people, shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord in Jerusalem, from Jerusalem. Now, remember, Isaiah says, "And it shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established." God's church, God's purified church, shall be established in the last days. This work that Isaiah foresaw in Isaiah chapter 2 is synonymous, brethren, with this work foretold in Ezekiel 47. Because Ezekiel saw waters gushing out, running out primarily, and then they gushed out. The waters then swell into a mighty river. Now Ezekiel 47 is talking about the work of the loud cry, brethren. The work of the loud cry. As the third angel's message swells into a loud cry, a great multitude of saints will be gathered. Isaiah chapter 2 and verse 2 says, "And many nations shall be joined to the Lord in that day." And God's people, as they go out as they begin very small, and we're going to see who this tiny rivulet really symbolizes to begin with, but as they go out, there's going to be a mighty swelling symbolized by this mighty river of Ezekiel 47. Now, brothers and sisters, who are these people symbolized by this tiny rivulet? This tiny rivulet, again, it just ran out. Who do these people really symbolize? Well, since inspiration says that the sealing is in two phases, we have a first fruit sealing and a second fruit sealing. In volume 3, Testaments to the Church, page 266, inspiration says the closing work for the church, the Seventh-day Adventist Church, is the sealing of the 144,000, whom John saw in Revelation chapter 14 and verse 1, having his Father's name written in their foreheads. Now, since John says in Revelation chapter 14 and verse 4 that the 144,000 are only the first fruits, naturally, a first fruit necessitates a second fruit. In fact, let's just go to a quotation found in Counsels to Teachers and Parents and Students Regarding Christian Education, page 532. Inspiration says here, the last paragraph, well, it's the first paragraph of 532. Inspiration says, "Very precious to God is his work in the earth. Christ and heavenly angels are watching it every moment. As we draw near to the coming of Christ, more and still more of missionary work will engage our efforts. The message of the renewing power of God's grace will be carried to every country and clime until the truth shall belt the world. Of the number of them that shall be sealed will be those who have come from every nation, kindred, tongue and people. From every nation and country will be gathered men and women who will stand before the throne of God and before the Lamb, crying salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb." Revelation chapter 7 and verse 10. Now, it's very interesting to notice, brothers and sisters, that inspiration here says, as we draw near to the coming of Christ, more and still more of missionary work will engage our efforts until the truth shall belt the world. And then inspiration says, when the truth belts the world, of the number of them that shall be sealed during that time, when the truth shall belt the world, will be the great company foretold in Revelation chapter 7 and verse 10, the great multitude which no man could number. Now, if you recall in Revelation chapter 7, John saw two groups of saints. In Revelation chapter 7, verses 1 through to 8, he saw the 144,000, which according to verse 4, were sealed from the 12 tribes of Israel. That's the church. But then he saw a great multitude in Revelation chapter 7 and verse 9 and 10, which came from every kindred, tongue, people and nation. Now here inspiration says that when the truth belts the world, who's going to belt it? Naturally, it will be the 144,000 symbolized by this tiny rivulet. How do we know that, brethren? If you go to Revelation chapter 14 and verse 7, there the Bible says, let's just go there, Revelation chapter 14 and verse 7, the Bible says in verse 7, let's pick it up from verse 6. "And I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel, to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people." The gospel is finally going to be belted to every kindred, tongue, people, and nation. But who's going to have that privilege? Who's going to have that grand privilege, brethren, of proclaiming the everlasting gospel to every kindred, tongue, people, and nation? Well, if you look at verse 6 in its context, pick up your Bibles, brethren, and look at the first 5 verses of Revelation chapter 14. It is referring to the 144,000. Look at verse 1. "And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his Father's name written in their foreheads." And then it goes on to talk about the 144,000 from verse 1 through to 5. And then John says that the gospel will be preached to every kindred, tongue, people, and nation. Sure it is, brethren, that it will be the 144,000 whom John refers to in verse 4 as the first fruits. Naturally, being the first fruits, they will be the first ones to be sealed, symbolized by this tiny rivulet. So the reason Ezekiel says in Ezekiel 47 and verse 2 that the waters ran out is because they were of small quantity. They were of little significance to begin with. They were only 144,000. But as the river begins to swell, because the angel begins to measure four times, and the fourth time, it was a river that could not be passed over. A river that could not be swam. A river that needed to be swam. A river that could not be passed over. Symbolizing the great multitude which could not be numbered. See, the reason Ezekiel says that the fourth time it was a river that could not be passed over, it symbolizes the great multitude of Revelation chapter 7 and verse 9 and 10, which could not be numbered. In other words, as the 144,000 begin to preach the loud cry message, because ever keep in mind, inspiration says in the book Acts of the Apostles, page 13, wonderful is the work which the Lord designs to accomplish through his church. His church triumphant. This is the church that will be clad in Christ's righteousness, fair as the moon, clear as the sun, and terrible as an army of banners. The church triumphant will go into all the world, conquering and to conquer. The church triumphant, brethren, is the 144,000. Those that withstand temptation and that will be sealed in the church. And then as the third angel's message swells into a loud cry, this is the work here foretold by the river, the mighty river of healing, that swells eventually into a river that could not be passed over. So my beloved, this is the work of the 144,000, the tiny rivulet of small significance to begin with, in comparison to the waters which were outside the gate. Now let's go to the book of Isaiah chapter 60. In Isaiah chapter 60 and verse 1, again the same work, brethren. Isaiah chapter 60 and verse 1, the same work is foretold, the work of the loud cry. Because this is what we're seeing here, brethren. This is the work of the church triumphant during the loud cry period. In other words, during the mark of the beast period. Isaiah chapter 60 and verse 1, the Bible says, arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. Which glory is the Bible referring to here, brethren? Because again, according to Acts of the Apostles, page 585, inspiration says all the books of the Bible meet and end in Revelation. Now in Revelation chapter 18, keep your hand there in Isaiah chapter 60 and verse 1. In Revelation chapter 18 and verse 1, the Bible says, and after these things I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. This is the loud cry message, brethren, that will be proclaimed by the church triumphant. This tiny rivulet, the 144,000. And as a result, John then sees and he hears another voice in verse 4. He says, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. So when John heard the other voice saying, come out of her, my people, this will be the work of the 144,000. This tiny rivulet that Ezekiel saw running out. And then as the 144,000 proclaimed the loud cry of Revelation chapter 18 and verse 1, as a result of that, a great multitude will come out of Babylon's domain, and that's what causes this tiny rivulet to swell into a mighty river, even a mighty river of healing. Isn't that beautiful, brethren? Now let's go back to Isaiah 60, because again, Isaiah 60 talks about the same work, the work of the loud cry of the third angel's message. Now after Isaiah says in verse 1, arise and shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee, The thee they refer to are naturally the people that will be proclaiming this loud cry message. The glory of the third angel's message as it swells into a loud cry. Now in verse 5, in fact, let's just read verses 2 and 3. Verse 2 says in Isaiah chapter 60, "For behold, darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall arise upon thee," that's God's true people, "and his glory," even the glory of the angel of Revelation chapter 18 and verse 1, "shall be seen upon thee." And then verse 3, Isaiah says, "And the Gentiles shall come to thy light, and kings to the brightness of thy rising." And then verse 5, Isaiah says, "Then thou shalt see and flow together, and thy heart shall fear and be enlarged, because the abundance of the sea shall be converted unto thee. The forces of the Gentiles shall come unto thee." Did you notice what Isaiah says? As a result of the glory of the Lord rising upon God's people, Isaiah then says in verse 5, "The abundance of the sea shall be converted unto thee." Now, what is Isaiah really talking about here? Can the literal sea be converted to God? No. Again, the sea in this context symbolizing God's people that will be converted to him during the loud cry period. When the third angel's message shall swell into a loud cry, and the 144,000 symbolized by this tiny rivulet of Ezekiel 47 and verse 2 running out, when the 144,000 proclaim the loud cry message, then as a result of that, during the loud cry period, the abundance of the sea shall be converted unto God. No wonder as the angel began to measure 1,000 cubits, the first time the waters were to the ankles. Then the second time they were to the knees. Then the third time they were to the loins. Showing that the great multitude was beginning to be ushered in into the ranks of God's true and perfect people. Now, this work, beloved, this work, my brothers and sisters, will be similar to that which took place on the day of Pentecost. Now, remember when the 120, according to Acts chapter 1 and verse 15, received the Pentecostal power in Acts chapter 2 and verse 1, they went out. God gave them a special gift, the gift of tongues. And they went out and they proclaimed the message to every creature that was under the face of the whole earth during that time. Now that was the prototype. The work in the antitype, when the 144,000 go out, will be very similar. But during this time, when God pours out the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit at this time will be poured out with even greater power. Because the wickedness during this time of the loud cry will demand a greater manifestation of God's power. And remember, in the prototype, during the days of the apostles, there were only 120 primarily to receive the outpouring of God's Holy Spirit. Now, when the loud cry begins, 144,000 guiltless servants of God will have the grand privilege of receiving the Pentecostal power, according to the book of Joel chapter 2 and verse 28. "And they will go out, brethren, filled with the holy fire of God, and bring in a great multitude which no man could number," which really, according to what we have read, is the great multitude, yes, but they are the second fruits of the harvest. They are the second group to be sealed. Because if you remember in the book Counsels to Teachers and Parents and Students regarding Christian education, inspiration there says in the first paragraph, "As we draw near to the coming of Christ, more and still more of missionary work will engage our efforts until the truth shall belt the world." This is the work foretold in Ezekiel 47. The truth will finally belt the world. But inspiration says there in page 532, "Of the number of them that shall be sealed when the truth belts the world by the 144,000 will be the great multitude," she says. The second fruits, which no man could number, that will come from every kindred, tongue, people and nation. So thus we see very clearly, brethren, that there are indeed two groups of saints that need to be sealed. According to volume 3, page 266, inspiration says the closing work for the church, the Seventh-day Adventist church, is the sealing of the 144,000 first fruits, according to Revelation chapter 14 and verse 4. But then in Revelation chapter 7 and verse 9, John then sees a great multitude which no man could number. And this great multitude will be sealed when the 144,000 take the loud cry message to all the nations. When the truth finally belts the world, then of the number of them that shall be sealed will be the great multitude which no man could number. Isn't that beautiful, brethren? That's so beautiful. It shows that the 144,000 being the first fruits of the harvest, Revelation 14 and verse 4, a first necessitates a second. Where there is a first, there must be a second. Let's go on to another statement, brethren, found in the book Evangelism, page 234. In the book Evangelism, page 234, regarding to the loud cry period, notice what inspiration says. No one has yet received the mark of the beast. The testing time has not yet come. There are true Christians in every church, not excepting the Roman Catholic communion. None are condemned until they have had the light and have seen the obligation of the fourth commandment. But when the decree shall go forth and forcing the counterfeit Sabbath, and the loud cry of the third angel shall warn men against the worship of the beast and his image, the line will be clearly drawn between the false and the true. Then those who will continue to transgress will receive the mark of the beast. That's very important, brethren. Because here inspiration says, no one has yet received the mark of the beast. The testing time has not yet come. But when the decree shall go forth and forcing the counterfeit Sabbath, notice now, and the loud cry of the third angel's message, and the loud cry will go forth warning men of that counterfeit Sabbath, the mark of the beast, then anyone during that time when the loud cry will go forth, anyone who continues after the light of truth has reached them, anyone who continues to transgress the fourth commandment will receive the mark of the beast. But the point is, brethren, the loud cry, according to that inspired statement, will go forth while the mark of the beast has been enforced. And it will be at that time, according to Revelation chapter 18 and verse 4, when John says, and I heard another voice saying, come out of her, my people. This is the great multitude which no man could number. Again, when the angel measured the fourth time, and what is the significance of the fourth time? What does the number four symbolize, brethren? The number four symbolizes globality. The four points of the compass. North, south, east, and west. Showing that when the gospel shall have belted the four points of the compass, symbolized by the words that Christ spoke in Matthew 24 and verse 14, remember Jesus said, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. But when the gospel shall have been preached in all the world during the loud cry period, then a great multitude will be gathered, which no man could number, from every kindred, tongue, people, and nation. So the reason the angel measured the fourth time here, the fourth time symbolizes the completeness of the gospel. When the gospel would have reached the whole world, then as a result of that, a great multitude will be gathered, which no man could number. And again, no wonder Ezekiel says that the fourth time, it was a river that could not be passed over, symbolizing again the great multitude which no man could number. That's so beautiful, brethren. That's so beautiful. But let's go back to Ezekiel 47. Let's go to Ezekiel 47. And let's look now at verse 6. The Bible says in Ezekiel 47 and verse 6, "And he said unto me, Son of man, hast thou seen this? Then he brought me and caused me to return to the brink of the river. Now when I had returned, behold, at the bank of the river were very many trees, on the one side and on the other." Again, Ezekiel saw very many trees on either side of the river, on one side of the river and on the other. Now as we go down to verse 12, we're going to understand more fully the significance of these trees and what they really symbolize. Let's go on now to verse 8. Ezekiel 47 and verse 8 says, "Now when I had returned at the bank of the river," so verse 8 says, "Then said he unto me, These waters issue out towards the east country and go down into the desert and go into the sea, which being brought forth into the sea, the waters shall be healed." So again, verse 8 says, "These waters issue towards the east country, and then they go down into the desert. But then the waters being brought forth into the sea," the Bible says, "the waters shall be healed." So again, the waters first of all take an eastward direction. And we've seen that the waters symbolize primarily, to begin with, as they ran out, the 144,000. Now, what is the significance of taking an eastward direction? Because these waters, again, to begin with, they take an eastward direction. Well, the east symbolizes the idolatrous world. Naturally, where the sun rises. It symbolizes, in this context, the idolatrous world. It goes to show that the 144,000, when the loud cry begins, they will go, first of all, to the idolatrous world during the loud cry. And they will preach the everlasting gospel to the world that is filled with idolatry, symbolized in Isaiah chapter 66 and verse 20. Let's go to Isaiah 66 and verse 20 very briefly, because again the same work is foretold there. In Isaiah 66 and verse 20, the Bible says, "And they," who are these people, "shall bring all your brethren for an offering unto the Lord out of all nations." Which group in Revelation chapter 7 came from all nations? The great multitude, which no man could number. But the Bible in verse 20 is actually going to tell us who are actually bringing them in. Look at verse 20 again. "And they shall bring all your brethren for an offering unto the Lord out of all nations, upon horses and in chariots and in litters, upon mules, upon swift beasts, to my holy mountain Jerusalem, saith the Lord." Notice now. "As the children of Israel bring an offering," that's their brethren from all nations, "into a clean vessel into the house of the Lord." So the Bible says very clearly, it's as the children of Israel, they are the ones, the Israelites, sealed from the 12 tribes of Israel, Revelation chapter 7 and verse 4, the 144,000. It's the 144,000, the Israelites, as the children of Israel, bring an offering from all nations, the great multitude. But notice, they're bringing them into a clean vessel into the house of the Lord, showing that the house of the Lord is a clean vessel, showing that the church must have been purified before God invites the nations to come into his church. Now, One Day Inspiration says, brethren, in volume 6, Testaments of the Church, page 371, Now One Day Inspiration says that the Lord right now is not endeavoring to bring many into the church because of the condition of the church members. And we can understand what Inspiration is really saying, brethren. But when God has his church purified, the church triumphant will then go out and bring in to God's church a great multitude, but they will come into a purified vessel. Let's go to Ezekiel 47 one more time. Ezekiel chapter 47. And verse 9. In fact, let's just touch on verse 8 just one more time. The Bible says, "These waters being brought forth into the sea, the waters shall be healed." Now, since these waters, the Bible says, once they're brought forth into the sea, the waters shall be healed. Then what is the significance? Because we've seen that the waters symbolize the saints on this earth. But the Bible says in verse 8, being brought forth into the sea, the waters shall be healed. Now we know that the sea is the most extensive part of this earth. It symbolizes eternity. Now when the Bible says the waters being brought forth into the sea, the waters shall be healed, it goes to show that the sea symbolizing the eternal sinless realms, the eternal sinless nations of the unfallen worlds. So the Bible saying that the waters being brought forth into the sea, the waters shall be healed, it goes to show, brothers and sisters, that we will need to be healed before we come in contact with the sinless realms of the other fallen worlds, of the other unfallen worlds. So the sea symbolizes eternity, the sinless realms of the universe. And we will need to be healed before we come in contact with them. Let's go on to verse 9. The Bible says, and it shall come to pass that everything that liveth, which moveth, whithersoever the river shall come, shall live. And there shall be a very great multitude of fish, because these waters shall come thither. For they shall be healed, and everything that shall live, whithersoever this river shall come. Now again, remember, going back to the sea, we recall that when the saints stand on the sea of life, on the great crystal sea, they are eternally redeemed. They are now in the sinless realms. So again, the sea symbolizes eternity. But before we get there, we need to be healed by the grace and the mercy of God. We need to be healed from every sin and every disease that is in this mortal body. Now, brethren, in verse 9, the Bible says there's going to be a very great multitude of fish. As a result of the river coming in contact with the nations, the Bible says there's going to be a very great multitude of fish. But these fish shall be according to their kinds. According to their kinds. As the great sea has different various kind of fish, these people are represented as being fish of different kinds. Again, showing that these nations will be of different nationalities. Remember in Mark chapter 1 and verse 17, Christ said, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. So the people here are represented as being fish that will be gathered during the great loud cry period. But they're going to be of various different kinds. Like the great multitude from all nations. Showing that during that time, the 144,000 sealed from the 12 tribes of Israel will go out and catch various different kinds of fish from all nations and kindreds and tongues and people. Now in verse 10, the Bible says, and it shall come to pass that the fishers shall stand upon it from Engedi even unto Englam. There shall be a place to spread forth nets. Their fish shall be according to their kinds, as the fish of the great sea, exceeding many. Now again in verse 10 it says that there's going to be two places where these fish are gathered, Engedi and Englam. Showing again that there are two fruits. Engedi symbolizing where the first fruits are gathered, the 144,000. But Englam symbolizing the world or Babylon, where the second fruits are gathered. But nevertheless, these fish shall be according to their kinds. Various different types of fish from all nations, kindreds, tongues and people. Now in verse 11, because remember Jesus said this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. But, brethren, it's only going to be preached for a witness. Not all of the nations will embrace the saving truth at that time. So let's read verse 11 now. The Bible says, but the miry places thereof, and the marshes thereof, shall not be healed. They shall be given to salt. Now, what does that really mean, brethren? although this mighty river of healing will go out and heal a great multitude which no man could number, yet the Bible says the miry places. Can you see on the pictorial presentation? On the picture, it focuses here on the miry places and the marshes. The Bible says in verse 11, these miry places and marshes, they shall not be healed. They shall be given to salt. Let's go to Luke chapter 17. In the book of Luke, chapter 17, and we're going to be looking, brethren, at verse 31 and 32. In fact, let's just look at verse 32. Jesus said in verse 32, remember Lot's wife. Remember Lot's wife. Now, why are we to remember Lot's wife in relation to the last days? Because if you remember, when Lot's wife came out of Sodom and Gomorrah, she done something that was in strict disobedience to the command of God. She looked back, and she was turned into a pillar of salt. Now remember, the Bible says here in Ezekiel 47 and verse 11, the miry places and the marshes shall not be healed. They shall be given to salt. Showing that they will not be healed. They're gonna perish in their sins. Like as Lot's wife was turned to a pillar of salt, and she perished in her sins. So likewise, there's going to be certain sects symbolized by the marshes and the miry places that will not accept the loud cry message, and they will perish in their sins. And that's what the significance is of turning to salt. They shall be given to salt. Like Lot's wife, they will perish because they did not embrace and receive the loud cry message. And they will receive the mark of the beast and perish for all eternity. That's very sad, brethren. But let's go back to Ezekiel 47 and verse 12. The Bible says in verse 12, and by the river, upon the bank thereof, on this side and on that side, shall grow all trees for meat, whose leaf shall not fade, neither shall the fruit thereof be consumed. Now remember, when we read verse 7, we said we were going to come back to the significance of the trees. Now it goes on to say in verse 12, it shall bring forth new fruit according to his months, because their waters they issued out of the sanctuary. And the fruit thereof shall be for meat, and the leaf thereof shall be for medicine. The fruit shall be for meat, and the leaves shall be for medicine of these trees. Now, as we read about these trees, brethren, they somewhat identify, or they're identical to the trees of Revelation chapter 22 and verse 2. Let's just go there. In Revelation chapter 22 and verse 2, John saw, as he beheld in vision, proceeding from the throne of God. In verse 2, the Bible says, and in the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river, there were the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. So the fruits and the medicine of the trees, and the trees themselves of Ezekiel 47, are somewhat identical to the trees and the medicine of Revelation chapter 22 and verse 2. Now, what is the significance, brethren? What is the significance? The significance is this, that the church, during the loud cry period, during this time that we're talking about, the church will be endowed with power from the throne of God to offer life eternal during this loud cry period with no tasting of death. With no taste of death. In other words, the 144,000, as they go out during this great loud cry period, they're going to be offering life eternal to the world during this loud cry period. Once the church has been purified, the church will be endowed with power from on high, from the throne of God, to offer life eternal with no taste in death. Oh, brothers and sisters, what a gift. What a gift. What a gift. to be amongst the greatest people that have ever lived on the earth. Do you know, brethren, in volume 9, Testaments to the Church, page 16, Inspiration says, it is impossible to give any idea of the experience of the people of God that shall be alive upon the earth when celestial glory shall be mingled with a repetition of the persecutions of the past. The people of God, Inspiration says, will walk from the very light proceeding from the throne of God. And we want to say glory be to God for that, brethren. So again, the significance is that the church of Christ, the church triumphant during this period of the loud cry, will be endowed with power from the throne of God to offer life eternal with no tasting of death to the world during the loud cry period. Oh, brothers and sisters, what a gift. So in summarizing, we have seen, brethren, that this house here symbolizes God's church in her purity. The 144,000 are symbolized by this tiny rivulet, very small to begin with, and of small significance, as Ezekiel saw it by the altar. But as it begins to grow, it symbolizes something of rapid growth. This symbolizes the great multitude that will be gathered during the great loud cry period. And brothers and sisters, we cannot afford to miss out on this wonderful work. No wonder Inspiration says in the book Acts of the Apostles, page 13, wonderful is the work which the Lord designs to accomplish through his church. Yes, through his church, but it's through his church triumphant, brethren. It's through the church clothed in the armor of Christ's righteousness, fair as the moon, clear as the sun, and terrible as an army of banners, when the church goes into all the world conquering and to conquer. And you can read that statement, brethren, in the book Prophets and Kings, page 725. Brethren, we have seen something very beautiful today. And the beautiful thing is that God has laid a great banquet for his people at this late hour of this earth's history. And it's up to us, brethren, to fall in line with God's program. Are we going to strive with all the power that God has given us to be amongst his greatest people, according to the book Joel chapter 2 and verse 2? A great people and a strong, there has never been or ever shall be, even to the years of many generations. I trust, brethren, again, as we go through these beautiful presentations, that we will be drawn closer to the Lord, to his bleeding side, and that his atoning blood may truly wash us and make us white, and that we will be found worthy to go to all the nations once God has purified his church, and that we will be found worthy to be amongst those great people, the church triumphant, as they triumph during this great loud cry period. Until we meet again, brethren, may God bless you and keep you. And may you be sanctified by God's eternal truth. And may you be washed and made white as God builds you up through his precious word. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen and amen. Praise God. Father in heaven, Lord, we want to thank you so much for your love, your mercies, and your kindness. Father, we want to praise you for all the things that you have done for us. We thank you for speaking to us once again, Lord. We glorify your name. Bless us now, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. And amen.
Trust that your hearts have been stirred by the ever-unfolding revelations of God's prophetic word. There are also many more prophecy studies available to you. For further information, please contact us at 1-800-729-7000. 7494 or visit us on the World Wide Web at www.3angelsherald.org. Thank you.